Hi friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we are going to see the news analysis dated 31st October 2018. Today we are going to see the following topics in prelims, which is the INS Tarangini after voyage across the world, and the second one is the soil biodiversity, which is mentioned in the Living Planet Index reported by the WWF. The third one is the commercial papers redemptions. Fourth one is the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, and the fifth one is the NASA Parker Solar Probe. The first news is the INS Tarangini returns after voyage across the world. This INS Tarangini is part of its first training squadron, and which is the first ship of the Indian Navy to have circumnavigating the globe in the year 2003 and 2004. It has commenced Lokayan 18, which is from Kochi, and it covers a distance of over 20,000 nautical miles to display the Indian flag at 15 ports across the 13 countries. And this ship is also circumnavigating the globe through the Indian Ocean region and then through the Red Sea. Via Suez Canal, it goes to the Mediterranean Sea. And then it goes through the Atlantic Ocean. And thereby it circumnavigates the whole globe. And this INS Tarangini should be compared with INS V Tarini. And this is an all women crew that is circumnavigating the globe, which has started in the year 2017. And the second article now we are going to see is the India among the nations that face grave danger to the soil biodiversity. And this article has been taken from the Hindu. And you all know that every year one question pertinent with report has been asked. So it is also essential to note that the Living Planet Index, which has been published by the Worldwide Fund for Nature, also constitutes a part of Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas. And in this atlas, they had reported that the country's high population makes it vulnerable to an ecological crisis. So, India's soil biodiversity is in grave danger. So, what is here, we have to see what is this soil biodiversity, as it would helpful for defining in the mains paper. So, here we have to note what is soil biodiversity, and soil biodiversity is the variability of living organisms, which is generally the microorganisms as well as the macroorganisms. Microorganisms, notably the nematodes and the tardigrades. Here one point we have to see that the tardigrades is the most deadliest living organism. That is the micro living organism. And one more factor is the macro fauna, that is ants, termites and earthworms. So only when these organisms present in the soil, it would further lead to the growth of the biodiversity. So it is essential to protect these microorganisms and the macroorganisms. But as of now, according to this report, this is in grave peril. So what are the threats caused due to this soil biodiversity degradation? So the threats associated with this biodiversity degradation is the loss of the above ground diversity, which has been mentioned in the Sustainable Development Goal number 15. And second aspect is the pollution and nutrient overloading because of the wide usage of the chemical fertilizers. The third aspect is the due to overgrazing and intensive agriculture, which is the main causing factor for the soil biodiversity degradation. And the fourth factor is due to the forest fires, which have been mentioned in the India State of Forest report. And this report says that the forest fires are considerably increasing nowadays, and soil erosion due to the improper cultivation methods like monocropping. And desertification, even though desertification has been addressed through the initiatives by UNCCD, which is the United Nations Conference to Combat Desertification, the desertification problem is still present. And climate change, which has been addressed through some initiatives of UNFCCC. So we have to take some more steps to address these problems, and thereby reducing the soil biodiversity degradation. Some more major causes of this soil biodiversity degradation are the 90% of the world's seabirds may have bits of plastic in their stomachs. 20% of the Amazon rainforest, which is the evergreen dense forest in the world, has also disappearing in the last 50 years. And 170 number of times the global temperature has been risen, which is going to cause a climate change factor intensively. And also the animal population of fish, birds, mammals and reptiles are declining by 60% within the time frame of 1970 to 2014. So these concerns should be immediately addressed, otherwise it will be intensively causing some more effects in the climate change. Also, in this Living Planet Index report published by WWF, they have stated the factors that are causing this biodiversity loss, which are over-exploitation of the natural resources and improper agricultural practices are also concerns here, which should be addressed through some initiatives of the world organizations. And the report also says about the India's per capita ecological footprint, though it is less than 1.75 hectares per person, it is causing more biodiversity degradation in the Indian soil just because of the high population, which is making vulnerable to the ecological crisis. Okay, here we have to note what is this ecological footprint. Normally there should be a demand supply match, but here it is the mismatch between the demand and supply, which lead to the over exploitation of the natural resources and thereby causing the biodiversity loss. So this should be addressed properly. And the third article is about the commercial paper redemptions, and this article has been taken from the Hindu. And what is it is in news is about 50,000 crore of the commercial papers are coming up for the redemption, which is the maturity period is going to get over. So what is the issue? As we all know that the recent ILFS company default, which is an NBFC, the share is being drastically reduced. In the Indian economy, most of the micro financial institutions and housing finance companies are dependent on the liquidity from the NBFCs and the mutual funds. So, if there is any drastic reduction of liquidity in this NBFCs, it is going to affect mainly these MFIs and housing finance companies. So, here we have to note what is the commercial paper, and it is a money market instrument to raise the short-term funds. Short-term funds in the sense, it is can be issued for a period of 7 days to 1 year. So it is a short-term debt instrument issued by a corporation. So this should be noted. Here, the government issuing of these short-term funds is called as T-bills, and this corporation issuing of short-term funds is called as commercial papers. And it is usually issued at a discount from the face value. For example, if the commercial paper value is rupees 1000, it will be issued at a price of rupees 900 at the time of issuance. When the maturity, that is the redemption period, is going to over, it will be refunded in the form of rupees 1000 rupees. So it doesn't have any interest rates. It is just discount from the face value during issuance. So to get benefited through this commercial papers, the company should have some criteria, which is it should have a tangible net worth of rupees 4 crore, and also it should have a credit rating from some rating agencies like CRISIL, ICRA, CARE, Fitch, etc. So these, apart from corporate companies, these commercial papers can also be issued by the primary dealers and All India financial institutions. And now, who can invest in these commercial papers? Individuals can invest, banking companies can invest, also corporate bodies, unincorporated bodies and non-residential Indians, foreign institutional investors can also invest in these commercial papers. And you can see here the denominations will be in rupees 5 lakh or multiples thereof. Here we have to note some other monetary instruments like call money and notice money, commercial bills, treasury bills, commercial papers, which we have seen now, and a certificate of deposits, interbank participation certificate, repo instruments and intercorporate deposits. So these, all these are short-term funding instruments. available in the Indian economy. The only difference is who issuing which bill. The like a treasury bill we have seen, it is the government issuing, and commercial papers it is corporate issuing. And now the fourth article we are going to see for prelims is the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, who is profoundly referred as the Iron Man of India. This article has been taken from the Hindu. And we have to know some facts regarding Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. And he is a barrister, he practiced law, and he is a follower of Mahatma Gandhi, and he is the senior leader of the Indian National Congress. And he should be noted that India's first deputy prime minister after independence. And on the first anniversary of independence, Patel was appointed as the Home Minister of India. As we all know, October 31st is the birth anniversary of Sardar Patel, which is the 143rd birth anniversary. So as a tribute to Sardar Patel, Indian government has unveiled the world's tallest statue, which is 182 meter tall, and this statue is profoundly referred as Statue of Unity, as he played a very important role of integrating 500 plus princely states with the dominion of India during the time of independence. So therefore, he prevented India being balkanized. And he is remembered as the patron saint of the India's civil servants, and the National Police Academy has been named after him. He also worked extensively against alcohol consumption, untouchability, caste discrimination, and for women emancipation. He also worked in Gujarat and outside India. For these contributions, he has been conferred with Bharat Ratna posthumously, which is the India's highest civilian honor in 1991. So now we are going to see the last article for the prelims, which is the NASA's Parker Solar Probe, which has been taken from the Indian Express. Some of the unique objectives of this mission is to trace the flow of energy which drives the solar corona and the solar wind, also to determine the dynamics of plasma and the magnetic fields of the solar wind, to also explore the energetic particles of the corona. So here we have to see what is the solar corona, solar wind, plasma, etc. Apart from this, the probe will also experience the temperatures of 1400 degrees Celsius. Okay, now we will see about this corona. And what is this corona is? It is the sun's outer atmosphere. Which extends to about millions of kilometers from the sun's surface. And next is the chromosphere, which is the outer layer of the sun, which is a very thin layer. So this photosphere is having the hottest temperature of 6000 Kelvin. Here we have to see what is plasma. Plasma is nothing but the ionized gas which is present in the atmosphere, that is in the corona region. So here we have to see what are the solar flares. You can see a sunspot here where you will find a high magnetic field, which over a period of time it will explode to give these solar flares. And this solar flares is also studied by this solar Parker probe. And one more thing the probe studies about is the solar winds. So these solar winds are result of this ionized gas of plasma. So to also study the sun's atmosphere, India is also working on a mission called Aditya, which will be launched in 2020 as expected. And the European Space Agency is also working on mission called SOLO, which will study about the sun's atmosphere, like this Parker solar probe is trying to do. Now we are going to see some of the topics for mains. The first one is the university and patents, wherein which we will be seeing about the India's IPR policy in 2016. And second one is the India's neglected groundwater crisis. And third one is the trade war, from which India what can gain. Fourth one is the Chinese cooperation on counter-terrorism. The first article regarding mains is the universities and patents, which is dealing with IPR, which is nothing but the intellectual property rights. So this article is taken from the Hindu. So this IPR questions can be potentially asked in paper 3 of mains. And so now we are going to see what is this intellectual property rights. Intellectual property rights is nothing but the intangible assets. It is the intangible asset which is an outcome of the human intellect. So some of the IPR are patents, trademarks, copyrights, GIs, trade secrets, utility model and designs, and also it includes plant breeders' rights. To promote this intellectual property rights, Indian government has taken many initiatives. So the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion under the aegis of Ministry of Commerce has taken the following three important initiatives, which is the National IPR Policy of 2016. And second one is the CIPAM, this Cell for IPR Promotion and Management, which has been tagged as the nodal implementing agency for this IPR policy. And third one is the IPR awareness programs. So now we are going to see about this new IPR policy 2016. The first major thing it says about is the IPR awareness. Although the scientific community is widening in present India, there is little awareness about the IPR rights. So we are duty bound to make it aware of the IPR. The second important specification is the generation of IPRs. In compared to global counterparts, India is having the minimum number of filing of IPRs, for which we need a legal and legislative framework reforms. The policy also speaks about the administration and management to effectively implement the IPR rights among the community. And the next aspect is the commercialization of IPR. And the Indian government has recently taken initiative of Atal Tinkering Labs in the schools, wherein which innovative labs will be established to promote the scientific researchers. Through this scientific researchers, the student community is also made aware about this IPR. So also the policy speaks about effective enforcement and the adjudication. The enforcement agency will be the CPAM, which we have seen in the last slide. And this adjudication is the if various scientific communities from other countries are registering this IPR, there should be a proper adjudicating procedure. But if you see the recently released Global Innovation Index report by the WIPO, which is the World Intellectual Property Organization, in collaboration with the Cornell University and INSEAD, this GII report ranks 126 countries based on some 80 indicators, which includes the intellectual property and research and development, mobile application creation, etc. And in this Global Innovation Index, India stands at 57th rank comparing to other 126 countries. And in this report, Switzerland stands first, followed by Netherlands and Sweden. The India has improved the GII rankings from 2015 to 2018 from 81 to 57. So, but although we have to have a proper focus on this IPR policy guidelines. Comparing with BRICS nations, India stands third. Though India's position is increasing comparatively, there are some weaknesses in the areas like the political stability and safety, ease of starting businesses, and environmental performances, ICT, that is the information communication technology usage, and overall education. So to address this, we have to recognize innovation forms a key role in driving the economic growth at higher levels. Okay, the India's neglected groundwater crisis. This article has been taken from the paper Mint, and this can be potentially asked in paper 3. As we all know, water forms the basic element for the sustenance of life in the world. We are in need to conserve and save water. So, if you see, the composition of groundwater present in the earth is only 0.61%, which is a very scarce resource for the human usage. So, it is need of the hour to save this groundwater from getting over. A statistic says that about 600 million people face high to extreme water stress. and about 75% of the households do not have the proper sanitized drinking water, and 84% of the rural households do not have piped water access. Also, 70% of our water is contaminated. This 0.61% among which 70% of water is contaminated. So India is currently ranked 120 among the 122 nations in the water quality index. To address this, international organizations have framed the sustainable development goal number 6, which says about clean and sanitized drinking water. In the recent Niti Aayog report, India's over-exploitation of groundwater has contributed to the worst water crisis in its history. So, supporting this, the World Water Development Report published by the UNESCO has also stated that India is the largest extractor of the groundwater in the world. And also, we have seen that 54% of the India's groundwater wells have declined over the past just because of this over-exploitation. And what are the problems that causing this groundwater crisis is the governmental initiative of giving the subsidies on electricity. If you give electricity subsidies to the farmers will overuse the electricity provided at subsidized cost for the irrigation purposes. And this is leading to the over-exploitation of the groundwater. And the second one is the vast majority of the groundwater pumps are unmetered, and if charged, they are at a flat, non-volumetric and highly subsidized tariff. So these governmental initiatives is also causing to the groundwater crisis. The government encourages farmers to produce the water-intensive crops through adopting the minimum support prices for these water-intensive crops like the rice and sugarcane. So, the combination of the minimum support price as well as the subsidization of the electricity has led to the groundwater crisis profoundly. All apart from the groundwater getting depleted, the MSP adoption has also led to the income inequality and unsustainable agriculture, which means the overusage of chemical fertilizers and other improper managements. If you see this infographics, it says that the sum of the states are performing good in the water resource management, like Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Maharashtra are performing good and proactively involving in the water resource management. On the contrary, some of the underdeveloping states is poorly performing in the water management. So we have to take immediate steps to conserve this scarce resource of groundwater. In this infographics, the demand and supply of water as of 2008, it is almost matching. But if we didn't take any proper measures to conserve the water, we will be facing a 101% of demand comparing to the supply. So the following are some of the proposed solutions to conserve the groundwater. As we have seen that the electricity subsidies are causing over-exploitation of the groundwater resources, we have to reduce the electricity subsidies. On an average, a 10% reduction in electricity subsidy would considerably decrease 6.7% of the groundwater extraction. So as a result, there will be, instead of giving electricity subsidies, the farmers can be compensated by giving the direct cash transfers for every unit they save. So ultimately, this will encourage the farmers to save more electricity and thereby reduce the over-exploitation of the groundwater. So it is also imperative to adopt the micro-irrigation techniques. For example, the Indian government has recently launched the Krishi Sinchai Yojana, which speaks about the micro-irrigation techniques to be implemented in the farming methods. And also, according to the CWMI report, adopting micro-irrigation techniques can save roughly about 20% of the groundwater annually. But the challenge is to convince the farmers to adopt such techniques. So, This recent Niti Aayog's CWMI report is a timely reminder of the need for the policy makers and researchers to come together to take the initiatives for conservation of the groundwater sources. So, it is also the need of the hour to have a sustainable change. Like as we have said that following the methods of micro irrigation techniques and region-wise cropping based on the water availability. It is also the central government in its 12th five-year plan proposed policies of participatory groundwater management, which means that the community participation for the water conservation should also be encouraged among the masses. It is a collaborative approach among the government departments, researchers, NGOs and the community members. Now we are going to see the third article, How India Should Play the Trade War, which is taken from the paper Mint and can be asked in paper 2 IR. So as we all know that the trade war between the largest two economies of China and US has many implications on other countries also. So at this juncture, how India is going to take it as an advantage and capitalize this trade war for its own benefits? You can see that many of the greenfield projects through foreign direct investments are invested in some of the Asian countries like Indonesia, Vietnam and Philippines. And this statistical data was reported by the UNCTAD. The international firms are trying to relocate the parts of the supply chains to other countries in the Asiatic region, thereby minimizing the losses from this trade war between the US and China. So, the lessons for India to improve its economic prowess is that identifying its opportunities. As of now, there are only few manufacturing capabilities present in the Indian manufacturing sector. But there is a huge potential in the manufacturing sector of textiles, clothing, auto components and certain types of chemicals. So it is imperative to focus on these manufacturing sectors where India could gain a comparative advantage. Much of the international trade is now between firms. A classic example for this is the Apple iPhones are designed by the Apple company in America, which is manufactured in China. So now it is the international between the firms rather than between the producers and the consumers. So this should be capitalized by the Indian markets. Also, to take advantage of the trade war, investments plays a prime role. So large investment projects should be backed by either domestic or foreign money. There are some areas which should be focused to make the foreign investments towards India, like import tariffs, investment policy, ease of doing business and GST, which should have a comprehensive revamp of the policies that encourages the exports. Even though India ranks in the in doing business report are improving and the increasing FDIs into the Indian markets, it is only flowing to the existing projects but not focusing on new industrial projects. Also, the twin shocks of GST and demonetization have reduced the foreign investments and disrupted the supply chains. In US, the domestic savings are far lower compared to the domestic investments, so which widens the current account deficit of US. So this may cause trade diversion from China to other developing countries like India, and or there may also be a trade disruption. If there is a trade diversion, it should benefit India if only if the government plays its card well. But in case if it leads to trade disruption, it will harm all the major economies in the world. In past, India had a huge potential in exporting labor-intensive goods to the developed world. But India has missed this opportunity. If the government focuses to bring back its potential to produce the labor-intensive goods, it may lead to the job creation which can address the employment demands. And at the same time, it will also address the BOP crisis from which India is struggling today. One more opportunity which India has missed out is the multi-fiber agreement that was proposed by the WTO, which provided advantage for India to export textiles and clothing. But this opportunity was grabbed by the other Asian countries like China, Vietnam, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. So India needs to focus on this multi-fiber agreement again. Trade will not be automatically diverted from China to India. So, it is the Indian response needs to encompass the trade, investment, tax, regulatory and exchange rate policies to make the investments in the Indian markets, thereby gaining the advantage from the trade war between US and China. Now we are going to see the last article, which is the Chinese cooperation on counter-terrorism, and this has been taken from the paper Mint, and this can be asked in paper 2IR. We have seen that the recent de-escalation after the Doklam standoff, we have been improving the Chinese cooperation in terms of security agreements and the summits like the Wuhan summit very recently. But this security cooperation agreement is nothing but an old version of security cooperation, which has been signed in 2005 and got lapsed 2 years ago. So this memorandum of understanding is a revised version. So whether this security cooperation agreement questions the transnational terrorism is a point of concern. Given the divergent interests on transnational terrorism, a meaningful cooperation will remain limited in this security cooperation agreement. The China's ambitious project of BRI, which extends over 60 countries in the world, needs cooperative partnership to counter the transnational terrorism. For this, they have signed the agreements with ASEAN, ASEAN Plus 3, APEC and SCO to counter the transnational terrorism. Also, the rising insurgency in the Xinjiang province among the Uyghur Muslims, which may potentially spread into Pakistan and Afghanistan, have attracted the Chinese government to make cooperation with New Delhi to counter the transnational terrorism. What are India's perspectives among this transnational terrorism is, India sees that Chinese presence is ambivalent in the cooperation of transnational terrorism. Also, the Beijing's refusal to sanction Azhar of Jaish-e-Mohammed at the United Nations Security Council is an irritant for the bilateral relationship between India and China. But Chinese immediate interest is to prevent the spillover of the militancy present in Afghanistan and the political unrest present over there, which can impact the Xinjiang province and thereby causing the Uyghur Muslims and to further the terrorism. In the recently concluded Wuhan summit, which is the informal summit, China and India has decided to start up the development actions in the third country of Afghanistan to counter the transnational terrorism. Beijing views Pakistan as a part of any long-term solution. But New Delhi sees Pakistan as the fundamental problem, a difference in approach that might hamper efforts to deepen the cooperative efforts in the future. Thank you.